Well, welcome to this presentation then. So I'm going to talk about production of Bcl-2 proteins involved in apoptosis. And in our lab, we are interested in apoptosis in general, but in particular, the Bcl-2 family of proteins that I'm going to talk about today. So I'm going to directly dive into the, well, apoptotic pathways. I'm sure you're quite familiar with this map. I mean, it's a quite complicated process, but it has to be complicated because this is the ultimate control and checkpoint for removal of cells. So we can differentiate between the extrinsic and the intrinsic pathway. So when the cell is doomed to die, the death signal is going outside the membrane to form the disc complex and then follow up by activation, a lot of effector proteins such as procaspase 8 is getting converted into caspase 8. BID is converted into TBID, but the ultimate termination of the cell is taken care about with the caspase 3 and 7 that will fragment DNA. But on the mitochondrial level, we have a tight balance between Bcl-2, the protein I'm going to talk about today, which is a membrane protein, and also BACs. So you can say that these have opposite effects as Bcl-2 will inhibit apoptosis, whereas BACs will drive the apoptosis forward. So, but eventually when the cell is doomed to die, BACs will create the pore in the membrane and you get the release of cytochrome C that will drive this apoptotic machinery forward. So you can guess that if this balance between these two proteins goes wrong, and this is of course a hot topic for cancer research because it's been observed that cancer patients that have an elevated and uneven balance of these proteins. So the protein Bcl-2 is actually a family of proteins. They are mainly alpha helical, and also they have conserved BH domains, which are important for the interaction between targets such as BACs. So as you can see here, Bcl-2, the protein of today's talk, has a transmembrane part, which is hydrophobic, so it's a membrane protein. It has four BH domains. I would say BH3 is the most important since it binds to BACs or other protein of interest. And we also have example of BACs that only has three BH domains. And you also have some odd examples that even lack this transmembrane part. So the question we want to ask in our lab is basically a few key points here. So first, we are very interested in pinpoint the location of Bcl-2 when it interacts with BACs at the mitochondrial level. And one thing that's turned to be the holy grail of our research is that we are lacking the structure of Bcl-2, which is an important protein to study, of course. So this is something we are investigating and trying to solve the full length Bcl-2 structure. And also this means that there are no complex structure between Bcl-2 and BACs present either. But as you can see, Bcl-2 is a rather small protein, but it's a membrane protein, so it still has its tricks to purify, which I'm going to talk about. So to the left here, we have an NMR structure of BCL-XL, and I want to point out that this is not Bcl-2, but this is a valuable mimic of Bcl-2 because it's soluble. So what people in general are doing, they are chopping off the C-terminal hydrophobic anchor of Bcl-2 in order to keep it soluble. And they also have modified and removed some loop regions. And thereby you can make actually this molecule soluble, but however is not the full representation of the intact Bcl-2. So our goal of our research is to work with a full length Bcl-2. And of course, when you work with the biophysics in general, you need a lot of protein. And especially when you turn into NMR, you need milligram amounts, you need a steady supply of protein. And when I started in the lab a few years ago, we were relying up on cell-free expression method. And honestly, it worked pretty nice. But the drawback is it's a quite fiddly process, and we got maximum, I think we got like a half milligram, 1 milligram out of each batch. And it's quite time consuming. It's not very easy to scale up. So I thought maybe you can do this with a recombinant expression system. And now I will show you this slide, but keep in mind that this slide is, it's based on several years of work. So now it has been optimized and went through a lot of iterations. But I hope this might serve as a generic protocol for, if you're working something similar, maybe you can use this as a guide at least to help you out with if you have some expression problems. So what we're doing, we have overexpressed, this is like a standard recombinant expression, at least in the first stage. So we overexpressed the protein in the PET vector, PET15B, that carries an N-terminal histag. And we grow the cells at 37 degrees. And I even grow them overnight at 37. And the reason I'm using M9 media here is simply because it seemed to help with the overall yield when the cell grows a little bit slower. And also you can mention in LB, the yield is not very great. And then next day, I follow up with resuspension in a fairly neutral pH buffer. And this step it's only to create the inclusion bodies. So in this step, we are not recovering the protein. Instead, this recovering step is done in the next stage, which is in presence of urea. So we are unfolding the protein and we add 0.6% of sarcosyl or sodium lauryl sarcosinate. And this seemed to do the trick. So this sarcosyl, it helps to resolubilize the protein. And then we run dialysis overnight against detergent that in our case happened to be Bri-35. The reason why we use Bri-35 is simply because it's cheap and it's available. And you can imagine when you do dialysis, you need quite a lot of buffer and it would be quite cost ineffective if you were using something else. And then we just continue with fairly standard affinity purification. We run a nickel column just on the bench and we do a detergent exchange here into DPC. The reason why we use DPC is also that it seems to be very compatible with NMR. So we screened a lot of different detergents and this dodecyl phosphatidylcholine seems to be the best candidate. And then we remove the histag, basically standard procedure with thrombin, and then we run gel filtration. And I just want to show you some examples of gels there from each step. So first we have the IMAC step. You can see it comes out more or less pure immediately. Keep in mind this has been optimized quite a lot. Next stage, we separate the histag and the pool here is basically the merged fractions from the previous step. And then we run gel filtration. And the good thing about the M9, we can now adopt this procedure to accommodate carbon 13 or 1915 label. We can even do deuteration of the protein, but then of course the yield will drop. But on average, we get around 3 milligrams per liter of cell culture, which is great for a membrane protein. So something we also did initially was to compare the 4UV CD spectrum with the Bcl-2 we obtained from this cell-free expression method. And it matches also very well with the recombinantly expressed Bcl-2. And just keep in mind that the x-axis is slightly different here, but we have confirmed that the fold is unaffected. So I was already talking about the DPC. So here is just an example run when the full-length Bcl-2 is run with NMR. So I'm quite sure you're all familiar with NMR, so I don't have to dig into details, but you get the correlation between the imide and the nitrogen, and each black dot here represents one amino acid. And this slide will just show you that we can obtain a fairly nice HSQC with the full-length Bcl-2 in DPC. And we can also apply this T2 relaxation filter where we can pinpoint the more flexible residues in the protein. So how this works is that the flexible residues that we have a longer relaxation rate, and then you can set a cutoff for the relaxation and you can fish these out. And these apparently must come from the membrane of the micellar core region. Something we also are working on quite heavily now is, I already hinted that we want to solve the structure of the Bcl-2 protein. But in order to do that, we have to deal with the fact that this is a quite large protein when you consider the added molecular weight in the micelle. So we have a problem with overlap in the spectrum, as you can see here, but we still managed to assign basically all the loop regions. So we need to find a way to overcome this crowded NMR spectrum. And to do this, we have developed basically a strategy where we can cut off the protein in several parts, which is probably not a very uncommon strategy. But the good thing here, which I'm going to show, is that we can cut these and they will still work as small puzzle pieces to get the full Bcl-2 spectrum. So you can basically overlay these smaller fragments that will form the full length spectrum. So this means we have truncated the protein, we have deleted this transmembrane part, and we also modified the N-thermal sections of the protein in a quite careful manner. We have taken account so that we don't interfere with the secondary structure, of course. So again, we have checked this with for UV. And to the top left here, you have the full-length Bcl-2 spectrum. And this is alpha helical protein, so you expect a dip at 222 and 208 nanometers, which we have, of course. And then you can see to the top middle here, the Bcl-2 delta TM, where we have deleted the transmembrane region. This also yielded a partially soluble protein, but we still retain the helical fold. And the same holds true for the rest of these mutations. You can, for as an example, the bottom left here, we have deleted the N-thermal first 82 residues. We still have a folded protein. The same holds true if we, in addition, delete the transmembrane part, and then we have chopped off quite a lot of the protein, but we still have the helical shape. Maybe one example in the end here, when we only have the BH4 domain and the flexible linker domain, then we start to see a spectrum that represents both a random coil and the helical spectrum, but that's not unexpected for this construct. So just to give you an example how this looks when you put it in the NMR spectrometer. So you can take an example here, either A or B, but just to show you that if we have the Bcl-2, the full length in black here, we can basically superimpose the red and the gray and we form pieces of the full length Bcl-2, which is nice. And that also proves that we can use this method as a tool to overcome this overlapping problem. And also we have done some efforts in the reconstitution of Bcl-2 into DMPC vesicles, which was the first attempt. So how this works, you have your protein in detergent and then you add lipid. In our case, we use DMPC as in the first try. You form mixed micelles and then you reconstitute and you remove this detergent with biobeads. It's a quite straightforward process, at least when something works, it's straightforward. But it worked. So after 2 days, you get you start from a perfect transparent solution. You end up with a cloudy solution, and then you form your protoliposomes. And then you ultracentrifuge. And this is just an example how it looks like. This is the real sample in the centrifuge tube. And you can see that the Bcl-2 and DMPC protoliposome has been trapped between the 15% and the 30% layer here. and an SDS gel further confirmed that we can do this for even for this delta TM when the transmembrane part has been deleted. We can also do it in PUPC and cardiolipin, which better mimics the mitochondrial membrane. So just to summarize a little bit, so maybe the most important thing here, we have found an expression method that works with Bcl-2, that is also a membrane protein, and now we can yield milligrams amount of protein. And we have also incorporated Bcl-2 into DMPC and other lipid systems as well. We also found that DPC is the candidate when it when we want to turn to NMR, it gives a very nice NMR spectrum. And also, in addition, we can use these shorter Bcl-2 constructs to together to aid us to form the full picture of how the Bcl-2 protein looks like in the NMR. So to finalize this talk, I want to thank the group leader, which is Gary Gremner, who is probably listening right now, and the rest of the group, Amik, who is doing some mostly of the NMR work nowadays, and also some previous members of the group. And we have collaborators in Gothenburg, in Prague, and also in Lund, and together with ESS and neutron experiments are going on in Orwell. And finally, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Jörgen. That was a very interesting talk, and having the aspect of NMR as well. That's interesting.
Yeah, this was actually a 30-minute talk that I had to squeeze in into 15, but yeah. But it's it was doable.
So we are, again, a little bit late, but just one quick question. You're using urea to unfold your membrane protein. Yeah. So we are commonly using urea to wash, of course, a little bit lower concentration than you're using, but commonly membrane proteins do not really always unfold, so to speak. So you have SDS present. So
yeah, I can give some input on that. The reason, I mean, when we started to establish this protocol, I was checking several papers and most of them actually used urea. And then also, which I don't show here, we have tried without urea, it actually works without the urea. So it doesn't necessarily, you don't need to unfold the protein to recover it. But I don't think it hurts. So we just kept on going with the urea. But you're right, actually.
You may not unfold it. That was my...
I think you will unfold it. But I mean, honestly, we haven't tested to run a CD spectrum in presence of heavy concentration of urea. Maybe you can form some residual, secondary structures in presence of high concentration of urea in that system. But I wouldn't be too surprised if it's not entirely going to unfold. That's probably true.